Hello all. So now let's discuss the rapid MCQ series of cardiovascular system by Dr. Ankit, pharmacology series. So the first question is asking, centrally acting sympatholytic agent used as an antihypertensive agent is. So for that, you must classify antihypertensive agents. Okay. So let's classify antihypertensive agents. So if you classify antihypertensive agents, so it's a very simple diagram. You just understand this diagram. So let's see how blood pressure in our body increases. Remember, blood pressure in our body increases when the blood supply to the vital organs like brain reduces. This brain starts a sympathetic discharge. That sympathetic discharge tends to increase BP. So in our brain, there are vasomotor centers in our medulla, which from where these adrenergic neurons, they are relayed. These adrenergic neurons goes to various organs of our body and tend to increase BP. Let's see what are the different antihypertensive agents we have. The first one, which will act at a level of brain, central nervous system, and reduces sympatholytic discharge, they are known as central sympatholytics. They are agonist at alpha-2A receptors. Then we have a drug which will block this adrenergic or sympathetic neurons. They are known as adrenergic neuron blockers. Now when this sympathetic discharge is increased, it goes to various organs like heart. On heart, there is beta receptors, which tends to increase systolic BP. On blood vessel, there is alpha receptors, which tends to increase diastolic BP by vasoconstriction. And this adrenergic neuron goes to the kidney, and kidney through beta 1 receptor releases renin. Renin activates a system known as RAS system, renin angiotensin aldosterone system, which tends to reduce the blood volume which is going into the urine, which has an antidiuretic action. So let's see what are the different drugs we have which are antihypertensive. So the first drug is central sympatholytic, which will block the sympathetic discharge in brain. Then we have adrenergic neuron blockers, which will block this sympathetic discharge from nerves. Then we have beta blockers, which will act on heart and kidney and suppress them. Then we have alpha blocker, which are vasodilators. We have diuretics, which will promote the blood loss into the urine, hence the volume of blood will increase. And then we have vasodilators, which will directly dilate blood vessel through some other mechanism of action. And lastly, we have calcium channel blockers, which will block the calcium channel on heart, cardiac muscles, and blood vessels, smooth muscles, and they will relax them. So this is the complete list of the drugs which we have among antihypertensive. So first we have sympatholytics, that is central sympatholytic acting at the level of brain. The drugs are clonidine and alpha-methyldopa. Alpha-methyldopa is used in pregnancy. Adrenergic neuron blockers, guanethidine, betalium, and reserpine. Beta blockers ending with the word lol, atenolol, metoprolol, etc. Alpha blockers, phentolamine, prazosin. Combined alpha plus beta blocker, labetalol and carbidolol. Okay. Then we have drugs inhibiting RAS activity, renin angiotensin aldosterone system. So renin inhibitor ending with the word iron, ACE inhibitors ending with the word pril, angiotensin 1 receptor blocker ending with the word sartan, and aldosterone or mineralocorticoid antagonist. The drugs are ending with the word on, spironolactone and eplerenone and canrenone. We have diuretics like thiazide loop and potassium sparing diuretic. We have vasodilators, which we will be discussing in great detail, and calcium channel blockers, again, we will be discussing in great detail. So this is the complete list of the drugs. So if you in this list try to find the centrally acting sympatholytic drug, acting at a level of brain will be clonidine and alpha methyldopa. That will solve the question number first. So the answer for the question number one is clonidine. Okay, clonidine. What is propranolol? Beta blocker. Prazosin, alpha blocker. Phenoxybenzamine, alpha blocker. Let's come to the next question. Which of the followings are vasodilators? So let's write the list of vasodilators now. Let's see what are the drugs we have among vasodilators. Okay. So the drugs we have among vasodilators are, either these drugs are artery dilators. Okay. Artery dilators. So they are potassium channel opener, because if potassium inside the muscle will move outside, the muscle will relax due to hyperpolarization. So the drugs are hydralazine, minoxidil, and diazoxide. There is one more drug, nicorandil, used in angina. We have calcium channel blockers. Among venodilators, we have nitrates, and among combined artery plus venodilator, we have nitroprusside. ACE inhibitors and alpha blocker, they are also vasodilators. Now, their common side effects are flushing because they dilate arteries on skin. They cause postural hypotension because of dilatation of leg veins. Due to sudden hypotension, there is reflex tachycardia. And due to vasodilatation, they increase plasma renin activity. So this is the basics of vasodilators. We have already discussed the great details of vasodilator in our combined detail videos. So if you want to find the vasodilators, let's write. What is alpha methyl dopa? It is not a vasodilator. It is centrally acting alpha 2 agonist, just like clonidine. So it is not a vasodilator. Nitroprusside, true combined dilator. Hydralazine, true artery dilator. Diazoxide, again true artery dilator. Hence the answer is alpha methyl dopa. Let's come to the third question. Which of the following antihypertensive drug causes sedation? Now the point is, antihypertensive drug which will cause sedation will be acting at a level of brain only. So the answer will be centrally acting sympatholytic drug that will produce sedation in brain, that will be clonidine. We have already discussed the side effects of clonidine. So clonidine side effect, you can write a mnemonic, HATSE. It produces hypotension as a side effect because the blood pressure will reduce in a great fashion. It causes analgesia, decreased perception of pain in brain. It causes dry eyes and dry mouth because of blockage of sympathetic cholinergic nerves. It is highly sedative drug and it causes impotency or erectile dysfunction. Okay, so these are the side effects of clonidine and alpha methyl dopa. They both are same drug. Let's come to the fourth question. Which of the following is a Rho kinase inhibitor? Now remember, any drug which is a Rho kinase inhibitor will end with the word sudil. Okay, so let's write the example. The first drug is fasudil. Fasudil is an approved drug for vasospastic angina because it relaxes coronary vessels, it causes coronary dilatation, hence it is given in vasospastic angina. Another drug is nitarsudil. Only right now two drugs we have. Nitarsudil is also a Rho kinase inhibitor. It's an approved drug for open angle glaucoma. Okay, open angle glaucoma. It reduces the secretion of aqueous humor. Hence the answer for this question is fasudil. And fasudil is given in vasospastic angina. Now other drugs are also anti-anginal drug that we will be discussing shortly. Now which of the following drug worsens angina? All of the following drugs can worsen angina except. So which will not worsen angina? The answer is oxyfedrin. Now what is oxyfedrin? Remember, oxyfedrin is a beta 2 agonist. And beta 2 receptor causes vasodilatation in coronary artery. Hence it is a coronary vasodilator. But right now this drug is not approved. Now what about dipyridamole? Remember, dipyridamole was an approved drug for angina. But now this drug has been banned. Why this drug has been banned? Because it was causing coronary steal syndrome. It was causing coronary steal syndrome. It was dilating coronary artery. It was dilating coronary artery in wrong place. Okay, not in the ischemic area. Thyroxine, remember, stimulates heart. Sumatriptane also causes vasospastic angina. We have already discussed in migraine. So right now, let's talk about the drugs which we have for the treatment of angina. So let's talk about anti-anginal drugs now. Okay, so let's write the list of anti-anginal drugs. So the list of anti-anginal drug is this one that you must remember. It's very important for you. Now, anti-anginal drugs, if a patient of angina comes to you, how to manage? Remember, if a patient of acute anginal attack comes, we have only one drug, that is nitrates. And we give sublingual nitroglycerin or isosorbide dinitrate. Why we give them sublingually? Because if you will give them orally, they will go to the liver and they become degraded. Hence, we give them sublingually. When we give them sublingually, they directly reach his heart by bypassing the degradation or first pass metabolism of liver. Hence, they are the fastest acting anti-angina drug. So it is acute angina. Now, drugs for chronic angina means that all other drugs are given for prophylaxis or prevention of angina, so that in future they should not occur. So the first line drugs we have is nitrates, beta blockers and calcium channel blockers. Then we have second line drug Nicorandil, a potassium channel opener. Dipyridamole, so the mnemonic is N-DRIFT. Dipyridamole has been banned. Why? Because it causes coronary steel syndrome. Ranolazine, it has now become the first line drug for chronic stable angina. Ivabradine, funny channel blocker, fasudil, rho kinase inhibitor, and trimetazidine, we will discuss PFOX inhibitor. Oxifedrin is a beta 2 agonist, it's a coronary dilator, it's under clinical trial. So these are the drugs we have among your anti-angina. So let's talk about one anti-anginal drug, that is ranolazine, a very important drug for you. You'll write, what is ranolazine? Ranolazine is now, where it is used, it has now become first line drug. For acute or chronic, we will write chronic. And which angina, stable or vasospastic, we will write stable angina. So it is given for prevention of angina. Second, what is the mechanism of action? The main mechanism of action of ranolazine is it inhibits late sodium channel on heart. It inhibits some sodium channels on heart, hence the heart will not function much, hence the demand, it will suppress heart, hence the demand of the heart will reduce, okay, hence the oxygen and nutritional requirement of the heart will reduce. Now it has one very great advantage that it can decrease blood glucose level. So how we measure blood glucose level? By HbA1c level. Hence it is good for diabetic patient. It is good for diabetes mellitus patient. And what is the side effect? Its main side effect is that it also blocks potassium channel on heart. Due to blockage of potassium channel on heart, it increases QT interval. Okay, and it is hepatotoxic. Okay, so these details you must remember among ranolazine. So keeping this thing in mind, let's solve the question sixth. Now let's start from D option. It is not indicated for acute attack of angina. It's absolutely true. It is rather given for chronic angina, prophylaxis. It improves glycemic control. True. Yes, it reduces HbA1c level. It is now recommended as a first line treatment for angina. It's absolutely true. It is now first line drug for angina. It causes hypotension. This is a false statement. Okay. So it does not cause hypotension, it rather causes QT prolongation and hepatotoxicity. Now the next question is, nitrates are used for all of the following conditions except which condition? Now, are nitrate given in congestive heart failure? True. Why? Because they are venodilators. As they are venodilator, they reduce the preload to the heart. They decrease preload. Hence, now heart has to function less. It is given in cyanide poisoning? True. Why nitrates are given in cyanide poisoning? Because nitrates, they convert hemoglobin into methemoglobin. So nitrates, they convert hemoglobin into methemoglobin. This methemoglobin act as a chelator for cyanide. It is a cyanide chelator. Cyanide binds to methemoglobin and it renders it non-effective. Now the point is, nitrates, they release nitric oxide. Nitric oxide relaxes muscle. It is given in esophageal spasm. Now it is very important because the pain of heart attack or angina is just like and the pain of esophageal spasm is similar. Sometimes we get confused. It is also relieved. Okay. Now it is not given in renal colic. Why? Because nitric oxide cannot relax the muscles of renal arteries or renal system. Okay, so the incorrect statement is renal colic. It cannot relax the smooth muscles of renal. It only relaxes the smooth muscles of GIT and blood vessels. Okay, now nitroglycerin causes all of the following except. Nitroglycerin is a type of nitrate only. Now if you talk about nitroglycerin causes all of the following except. The first question is hypotension and bradycardia. The answer is false. Remember, as we know that nitrates are vasodilator. as we know that the nitrates are vasodilator, can we say they will reduce diastolic blood pressure? Remember, when there is sudden vasodilatation, how the body will compensate? There is reflex tachycardia. Reflex tachycardia will try to increase systolic blood pressure, and this will compensate to maintain your mean arterial pressure. So just you have to remember a point: when there is sudden vasodilatation, to maintain the pressure, the heart beats more. Hence, vasodilatation causes reflex tachycardia, not bradycardia. It causes methemoglobinemia, it's true, we have already discussed. It causes hypotension due to vasodilatation with reflex tachycardia, the answer is absolutely true. And it causes vasodilatation, true. Hence, the incorrect statement is not bradycardia, it's tachycardia. Now, coronary steel syndrome is seen by, we already know, it's dipyridamole. Because dipyridamole relaxes or causes coronary dilatation in non-ischemic area. Now, what is the list of the drugs which causes coronary steel syndrome? Because of this reason, dipyridamole in angina has been banned. Now, the drugs which causes coronary steel syndrome are HIND, HIND. This is the mnemonic. The first drug you will write is hydralazine. Second one, general anesthetic agent, isoflurane. Nitroprusside. And dipyridamole. These are the agents that causes coronary steel syndrome. So remember the mnemonic HIND. Okay. Now, what about other three drugs? Remember, other three drugs are used in angina. Okay. Calcium channel blocker, diltiazem and verapamil, and beta blocker, propranolol. Now, the nitrate that does not undergo first pass metabolism in liver. Remember, the drug which will not undergo metabolism will be mononitrate, and make the full form as isosorbide mononitrate. Okay, so isosorbide mononitrate, when given orally, it comes into the GIT, it enters into portal vein blood, and through portal vein blood, all the drug first leaches into the liver, and from liver it will form inferior vena cava and reaches heart. Now, before the drug can reach into the heart, remember, liver degrades the drug. This is known as first pass metabolism. Isosorbide dinitrate does not undergo or does not get degraded in the liver. Rest all other nitrates are degraded in the liver. Because of this reason, if you will give 100 mg of isosorbide 9 nitrate, 100 mg of this nitrate reaches to the heart. Hence, it has 100% oral bioavailability. Okay, so very few drugs have 100% oral bioavailability. One of them is isosorbide mononitrate. Okay, rest all other nitrate, remember, are undergo degradation in the liver before they can reach to the heart. Mechanism of action of sodium nitrite and cyanide poisoning, we already know, they convert hemoglobin into methemoglobin, which act as a chelator for cyanide. Now, glycerol trinitrate is given by sublingual route. Now, the point is, if you want to bypass this first pass metabolism on liver, you can give the drug below the tongue. If you will give the drug below the tongue, remember, the drug directly comes into superior vena cava and it can directly reach into the heart through sublingual vein. So if you will give a drug sublingually, it will bypass the first pass metabolism of liver. That is why to remove this, to prevent this degradation of liver, we can give a drug sublingually. Hence, why we give the drug by sublingual route? The answer is to bypass the first pass metabolism of liver, that is hepatic first pass metabolism. So why nitrates are given sublingually? To bypass this first pass metabolism. Now the next question is, calcium channel blockers are used in all of the following statement except. Now point is, sir, calcium channel blockers are of two types. They block calcium channel. Now calcium channel blockers, remember, they block calcium channel on heart and on blood vessels. Okay, on cardiac muscle and smooth muscle. If they will block calcium channel, which is specially present on SA node and AV node, can we say they will reduce the excessive heart? Hence, the heart will get suppressed. Now, if the heart will not beat more because the calcium channel have been suppressed, remember, they decrease the requirement of oxygen and nutrition by the heart. Hence, they are given for the treatment of angina. And they also reduce the heart rate. Hence, they are given in arrhythmias. And in which arrhythmia? Remember, they are the drug of choice for SVT, supraventricular tachyarrhythmia. Now, in blood vessel, they are used, they will produce vasodilatation because calcium causes contraction, vascular contraction. Hence, they are used in the treatment of hypertension. So, calcium channel blockers, they have these three uses: angina, arrhythmia, and hypertension. But if you think the logical side effect, if this heart will become more suppressed, by SA node becomes more suppressed, can we say it will lead to bradycardia? And can we say if AV node gets suppressed, it will lead to blockage of conduction through AV node? So it can lead to heart block. Because of this reason, if the patient is already having some defect in SA node, if there is some defect in SA node, it is known as sick sinus syndrome. When the SA node is already diseased, we should not give calcium channel blocker. So they are absolutely contraindicated in sick sinus syndrome. And suppose AV node is not conducting, that condition is known as second to third degree heart block. We should not give calcium channel blockers. Okay. So if you talk about this question, if you talk about they are used in angina, true. Okay, they are used in angina, true. They are used in supraventricular tachyarrhythmias, arrhythmias, true. They are used in hypertension. But remember, they are absolutely contraindicated in sick sinus syndrome. Now remember, there is one more class of drug which causes bradycardia and heart block. That drug is known as beta blockers. Beta blockers also on heart causes bradycardia and heart block. Remember, beta blockers should never be combined with calcium channel blocker. Okay, it should never be combined with calcium channel blocker like verapamil, diltiazam, because it will lead to marked bradycardia and complete heart block. Okay, now the next question is asking that which of the following statement is true about nitrates. So in this question, it is asking about the mechanism of action of nitrates. So let's talk about the mechanism of action of nitrates now. Okay. So let's see how nitrates, they produce their action. Okay. So this is about nitrates. There are two drugs which releases nitric oxide, and let's see. So suppose this is a drug known as nitrates. Nitrates, if you can see, they will enter into the smooth muscles. And with the help of enzyme mitochondrial aldehyde dehydrogenase, known as MAD enzyme. This enzyme is also known as glutathione reductase enzyme. This enzyme liberates nitric oxide from them. And this nitric oxide, which is generated from nitrate with the help of this enzyme, stimulate one enzyme inside the smooth muscle known as guanyl cyclase. It's a very important question. Remember this point, guanyl cyclase. Guanyl cyclase converts rapidly GTP into cyclic GMP, and this cyclic GMP relaxes smooth muscle, thereby producing vasodilatation. How, sir? Because it will cause dephosphorylation of myosin. The phosphate group to myosin will get separated. Why? Because it will activate an enzyme phosphatase. Phosphatase will remove phosphate, and it will inhibit kinase. Kinase generally attaches phosphate. Hence, myosin will be not phosphorylated. This unphosphorylated myosin cannot bind to actin. Hence, the muscle will not contract. So, there is one more drug known as nitroprusside. Remember, nitroprusside also acts in a same fashion, but nitroprusside does not depend upon these MAD enzyme to function. Okay? Hence, it can directly stimulate guanyl cyclase. So, this is the mechanism of action of nitrate. Keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about this question 14. So, the first question is asking, nitrates, they act by increasing cyclic GMP level, which causes dephosphorylation of myosin light chain kinase. The answer is absolutely true. They are metabolized, or they generate nitric oxide by glutathione reductase, also known as MAD enzyme. It's absolutely true. Now, as they will relax smooth muscle, can they be used in achalasia cardia? The answer is absolutely true, because in achalasia cardia, the esophagus and stomach, this lower esophageal sphincter, it undergoes into spasm. And if you will give nitric oxide, it will relax this sphincter also. Hence, the correct answer is all of the above. Now, nitrates, they reduce myocardial oxygen consumption by all of the following mechanism except. So, it's asking about how this nitric oxide, which has been generated by nitrate, is useful in heart diseases like angina and MI. Okay. So, let's see what is the importance of this nitrates in angina. So, if you talk about how this nitrates, they are important. We already know that nitrates, they will release nitric oxide, which will relax and produce vasodilatation. We know that nitrate will produce vasodilatation. Now let's see what is the role of this vasodilatation, how it is good for heart. So if you talk about acute MI and stable angina or acute attack of angina, the main mechanism of nitrate is it causes venodilatation. By dilating veins, it will reduce the blood which is coming to the heart. This is known as reduction in preload. Due to reduction in preload, now if the total amount of the blood which is coming into the heart will become less. Hence, after the diastole is over, the total amount of the blood into the heart is reduced. It is known as it will reduce end diastolic volume. Due to reduction of end diastolic volume, now the heart will pump lesser amount of the blood forward. It is known as there will be reduction in systolic duration. Hence, it will reduce systolic duration. So, can we say if the duration of systole is reduced, the heart will remain for the longer duration of time in diastole? And remember, coronary artery, they supply the blood to the heart during diastole. Because in systole, during systole, the coronary artery becomes crunched between the muscles. So, this is the mechanism of action of nitrate in acute angina, stable angina and acute MI. They reduce preload by venodilatation. Try to remember these two points. While in vasospastic angina, they can directly dilate coronary artery by production of nitric oxide. Generally, endothelial cell produces nitric oxide, but in vasospastic angina, endothelial cells are defective. So, in this case, nitric oxide will produce and it will dilate coronary artery directly. So, keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about this question. Now, nitrates, they increase left ventricular end diastolic volume or pressure. It's absolutely false. They will rather reduce it. Why? Because the blood which is coming to the heart will be less. Hence, the left ventricular volume, and volume is directly proportional to pressure, will reduce. Okay. So, it's a false statement. Next is, by direct reduction of oxygen consumption of myocardial cell. Yes, true. Because now the heart will have to beat less. It dilates capacitance vessel. Capacitance vessels are also known as veins or reduction in preload. It's absolutely true. And slowly the size of the heart will reduce because the heart is functioning less. So the incorrect statement is A. Okay. Nitrates cause all of the following except. It decreases the heart size in long term. Yes, true. That is why it is given in angina and MI. It increases cardiac work. It's absolutely false. If it would have been increasing the cardiac work, it is bad for angina and MI. It must reduce the cardiac work. It is preload reduction. It's absolutely true. This is the main mechanism of action, venodilatation. They also dilate cutaneous blood vessel. True. They are venodilators. They can dilate any vessel in the body. Now, calcium channel blockers are used in, so it's a repeat question. Angina, true. Arrhythmia, true. Heart failure, true. Okay. Hypertension, true. Sorry. We'll write angina, yes, they are used. We have already discussed arrhythmia, true. Hypertension, true. Remember, calcium channel blockers are absolutely contraindicated in heart failure. They are absolutely contraindicated in heart failure. The reason is they cannot reduce cardiac hypertrophy. They cannot reduce cardiac hypertrophy or cardiac remodeling. Because the main problem in heart failure is the heart has become hypertrophied and this damaged heart cannot function. Calcium channel blocker cannot reduce cardiac hypertrophy, and they rather they rather reduces cardiac output. So they will rather suppress the heart, and it will rather reduce the cardiac output, which will rather increase mortality. So they will directly suppress the heart already in congestive heart failure. Already in congestive heart failure, remember the cardiac output is less. So they are absolutely, remember, if the C word will come, remember congestive heart failure never given. So what are the drugs we give in congestive heart failure? The drugs which can reduce cardiac hypertrophy are given in congestive heart failure. Okay, so the list of those drugs are which are given in congestive heart failure are, so these are the drugs which are given in congestive heart failure, and these drugs, they can inhibit remodeling. The mnemonic is Sahib. So these are the drugs which are given in congestive heart failure. So sacubitril, it's a neutral endopeptidase inhibitor, also known as neprilysin inhibitor. It increases the level of natriuretic peptide, which is good for the heart. ACE inhibitors, ARB, angiotensin 1, aldosterone receptor antagonist, hydralazine isosorbide dinitrate, known as Bidel. One will dilate artery, one will dilate vein, hence they are known as bidilator. Evabridine, blocking funny channels, and beta blocker. Remember, only three beta blockers are given in heart failure. Those are carbidolol, bisoprolol, and metoprolol succinate. And these drugs can inhibit cardiac remodeling. They can prolong the life of a person. Hence, they are given in heart failure. Calcium channel blockers are contraindicated in heart failure. Drugs not to be given in ischemic heart disease or MI. Atenolol, beta blocker, remember, they are the drug of choice in ischemic heart disease. ACE inhibitor, they are also given. Streptokinase is also given to open the coronary artery. Okay. Now the point is isoproterenol. Remember, isoproterenol is a beta agonist. It is a beta agonist. If you will stimulate beta 1 receptor on heart, remember, it rather causes cardiac stimulation. And remember, cardiac stimulation will increase the oxygen and nutritional requirement of the heart. So it will worsen ischemic heart disease. Remember, it is absolutely contraindicated. Okay. Now, potassium channel opener with anti-anginal effect, we have already discussed, is nicorandil. So let's write the mechanism of action of these anti-anginal drug. Nicorandil is a potassium channel opener. Okay. Dipyridamole causes adenosine efflux. Adenosine efflux causes coronary dilation, but it dilates coronary artery in non-ischemic area. Hence, the blood will get diverted from ischemic to non-ischemic area. It will rather worsen angina. It causes coronary steal. Hence, this drug got banned. Trimetazidine is a PFOX inhibitor, that is partial fatty acid oxidation inhibitor. The heart will shift metabolism from fats to carbohydrate. Oxifedrin, we have discussed, is beta 2 agonist. Okay, so remember. Now, all of the following drugs act by blocking calcium channel. So let's talk about now the drugs we have among calcium channel blockers. Okay. So if you want to, this is the complete list of calcium channel blockers. Now, what are calcium channel blockers? These are the drugs which block some L type of voltage gated calcium channel. This L type, L means long type, they are present on muscles. So if the calcium will not enter into the muscle will not contract, hence they will cause inhibit muscle contraction. Now these calcium channel blockers, they are divided into two. One is DHP type, second is non-DHP type. DHP is known as dihydropyridine. Okay, dihydropyridine, any drug will, there are many drugs, and all drugs among dihydropyridine will end with the word dipine. They will end with the word dipines. And among non-DHP type, we have only two drugs, verapamil and diltiazam. So the one example is already written, nifedipine. Now the basic difference between DHP and non-DHP is that DHP type will only act on smooth muscles of blood vessels. They will not act on heart. While non-DHP type, they will act on both, but more on heart. Verapamil is more cardio specific. Dilti Azam is less cardio specific, less on blood vessel, and dihydropyridine does not act on heart. They only act on blood vessel. They are artery dilator. Okay, so that is why verapamil and Dilti Azam, they cause marked cardiac suppression. They should never be given with beta blocker. It will lead to bradycardia and conduction block. Okay, but remember, the dipines can be given with beta blocker. Okay, now these are the certain uses of dipines, like nifedipine, amlodipine, longest acting, nicardipine, IV longest acting. So amlo is oral longest acting, so drug of choice for normal hypertension and safest drug. Nicardipine, drug of choice for emergencies. Nitrendipine, nislodipine, nimodipine can enter into the brain. It will dilate the cerebral blood vessel. Hence, it is a cerebroselective calcium channel blocker, nimodipine. It is given for subarachnoid hemorrhage. Clavidipine, the shortest acting because it is degraded by esterases enzyme. Isradipine, inhibit SNOD. So these are the various calcium channel blockers. So remember, calcium channel blockers are of two types, non-DHP in summary. In non-DHP, we only have verapamil and Dilti Azam, which are acting on heart. While the second calcium channel blocker is DHP type, which are vasodilator. Okay, and all these drugs, they will end with the word dipine. So keeping this thing in mind, try to solve the question number 20. So nicardipine, yes, dipine word is coming, Dilti Azam and verapamil. Okay, now what is dantrolene? Dantrolene is rather a ryanodine receptor antagonist. Okay, and ryanodine receptor is present on smooth endoplasmic reticulum. When you will block this receptor, remember, smooth endoplasmic reticulum will not release calcium and it will relax all skeletal muscles generally. Smooth muscles also, but it will relax skeletal muscle. It is rather given in the treatment of hyperthermias. Dantrolene is rather given in the treatment of hyperthermia. Now, amyl nitrite is given by which route? Now, amyl nitrite, if you remember, it is overall the fastest and shortest acting nitrate. Okay? And it is given by inhalational route. And as it is the fastest acting drug, it is given in a very severe or emergency condition. It is the drug of choice for cyanide poisoning. It will rapidly convert hemoglobin into methemoglobin. Okay? So the answer is inhalational route. Now, propranolol should not be given to a patient. Now, remember, LOL word is coming, so it must be a beta blocker. It should not be given in the patient with which of the following drug? I already told you that calcium channel blockers and beta blockers should not be combined. So, verapamil and Dilti Azam, which are acting on heart, these verapamil and Dilti Azam, which are acting on heart, they should never be combined with beta blockers, because it will lead to marked bradycardia and complete heart block. Okay, so it is absolutely contraindicated with verapamil. So verapamil is absolutely contraindicated in, we know that verapamil is given in hypertension, true. It is given in angina. It is a drug of choice for SVT. Would you like to give verapamil in heart block? Would you like to give verapamil blocking the calcium channel in heart block like condition? Absolutely contraindicated. Okay, we have already discussed. Now, what is enalapril? Remember, any drug ending with the word pril is a ACE inhibitor. Okay, now what is ACE? ACE stands for angiotensin 1 convertase enzyme. Angiotensin 1 convertase enzyme. Now, the function of angiotensin 1 convertase enzyme is to convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. Now remember, angiotensin 2 is the main species in our blood which increases blood pressure. Hence, if you will inhibit this conversion by giving ACE inhibitors, it will reduce the blood pressure by reducing the level of angiotensin 2. But remember, this ACE enzyme is a non-specific enzyme. It has other functions also. Its other function is to degrade. Normally, this ACE enzyme also degrades bradykinin. It also degrades substance P. Okay, it degrades bradykinin and substance P. If you will inhibit this ACE enzyme, the level of bradykinin and substance P will increase. Hence, the answer for this question is bradykinin. Now, the point is, this increase in bradykinin and substance P level, remember, produces the side effect of ACE inhibitor. It produces severe allergic reactions. Bradykinin produces severe allergic reaction. The names of those allergic reactions, you can write a mnemonic, Daru. So, it produces dry cough. Dry cough is the most common and characteristic side effect of ACE inhibitor. Okay. It also produces angioedema. It produces rhinitis. And on skin, it produces urticaria. All these are the examples of allergic reactions. Okay. Now, all are dihydropyridine. Remember, dihydropyridine are calcium channel blocker. And they will end with the word dipines. And they are artery dilators. So, we have already tried to find the word dipine now. So, the answer is nifedipine, nimodipine and phelodipine. So, the answer for this question is verapamil. So, verapamil is not a dihydropyridine. It is rather non-DHP type of calcium channel blocker. When nitrates are combined with calcium channel blocker, what will happen? Remember, nitrates are venodilator. And they will reduce preload. While calcium channel blocker DHP type, remember they are artery dilator and they will decrease afterload. Afterload means the heart which is pumping the blood forward. Now due to artery dilatation, it can easily pump the blood forward. So the answer for this question is the arterial pressure will reduce. Okay, arterial pressure will reduce. This is the answer. Now, calcium channel blocker with maximum effect on conduction in heart. We know calcium channel blocker which are acting on heart are two, verapamil and diltiazem. And which was the most cardio specific? Think and tell me. The most cardio specific is verapamil. It has maximum effect on heart. Okay. So, answer is verapamil. Next answer would be diltiazem. Dipines, they have no effect on heart. Okay, phenylalanine is not a calcium channel blocker. Now, all other toxicities seen with amiodarone therapy except. So, now the 28th question is asking, all other toxicities seen with amiodarone except. So, remember, amiodarone is an antiarrhythmic drug. So, now we will be starting the concepts of arrhythmias also. So first we will write the side effects of amiodarone. Remember, amiodarone, the first side effect is it causes thyroid abnormality. Why? Because amiodarone, as IOD word is coming in amiodarone, as you are seeing, IOD word is coming. IOD means it contains iodine. So amiodarone contains iodine. It contains around 37% iodine. And remember, iodine causes both hypothyroidism as well as hyperthyroidism. Hypothyroidism due to iodine is known as Wolff-Chaikoff effect, and hyperthyroidism is known as Jord-Basedow phenomena. It causes pulmonary fibrosis. Remember, pulmonary fibrosis is the most dangerous side effect or most severe side effect of amiodarone. It causes peripheral neuropathy. Okay, it causes peripheral neuropathy. It causes proximal myopathy. It damages muscles also. It causes photosensitivity. Photosensitive reactions. Now, as we know that iodine, which comes in betadine, is violet in color or purple in color. If it will get deposited in skin, it can lead to purple man syndrome. Okay, it can lead to purple man syndrome. So these are the other effects. Now the last two effects of side effects of amiodarone is it causes liver damage or cirrhosis, and it causes corneal micro deposits. It gets deposited in cornea or corneal deposit. This corneal deposit occurs in cornea just like a flower, like this. Like a flower, like this, a tree, inverted tree. This is known as vortex keratopathy. Vortex means a bunch of flower. Okay, so vortex keratopathy. So these are the side effects of amiodarone. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Try to solve now the question number 28. It causes pulmonary fibrosis, it's true. It causes corneal microdeposits, true. It causes cirrhosis of liver, true. So the not true statement is productive cuff. Okay, now true about quinidine. Now quinidine is also an antiarrhythmic drug. It's a class 1A antiarrhythmic drug. Okay, now class 1A antiarrhythmic drug, remember they block sodium channel as well as they block potassium channel on heart. Now you know if the action potential duration of the heart, if you recall, which we have discussed in our videos also, there is phase 0 due to movement of sodium. So if you will block sodium channel, any antiarrhythmic drug blocks sodium channel, it will reduce the slope of phase 0. Okay, it will reduce the phase slope of phase 0. It will become like this because sodium channel will open very slowly. And we know phase 1, 2 and 3, they occur due to outward movement of potassium. If you will block potassium, the potassium channel, it will take more time to move outside. So this action potential duration will increase, APD. So blockage of potassium, remember, increases action potential duration, which is also known as effective refractory period will increase. It will increase effective refractory period. Now the point is, if effective refractory period is increased, if some impulse will come in between, the heart may conduct in between. This arrhythmia, which can occur due to blockage of potassium channel, is known as torsades de pointes. So remember, if effective refractory period increases, the heart may conduct in between. That may cause torsades de pointes, because this wave on ECG is known as Q, end of phase 0, and end of third wave is known as T. This QT interval becomes prolonged because of increase in a relative refractory period. QT prolongation occurs. So remember, any drugs that block potassium channel prolongs QT interval on ECG, and it can cause torsades de pointes. Okay, now keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about now the side effects of quinidine. Now the most common side effect of quinidine is it causes diarrhea. Now quinidine also block alpha receptor. Due to blockage of alpha receptor, it causes hypotension, because alpha receptor causes vasoconstriction. Due to sudden hypotension, we know there is reflex tachycardia, and which can provoke arrhythmia. And lastly, quinidine is obtained from a plant known as Cinchona autumnal. Long-term consumption of quinidine causes synchronism. In synchronism, there is ear defect. It may lead to tinnitus and permanent deafness. And in CNS, it will damage neurons, which can lead to seizures and neuropathy. So these are the side effects of quinidine. So keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about this question number 29. It increases refractory period. It's absolutely true. It increases the relative refractory period. We know it's true. Okay. The next question is, it is used in hypertension? No, false. It is rather used in arrhythmia. It is rather used in arrhythmia. Then it causes paradoxical tachycardia. Yes, it causes tachycardia. We know it reduces relative absolute refractory period. It's false statement. It rather increases effective refractory period. Synchronism is seen. It's absolutely true. So the incorrect statement is B and D, and the correct statement is A, C and E. So A, C and E is the correct answer. Okay. Now let's talk about the question number 30. Now the question number 30 is asking urgent treatment of procainamide toxicity. So first let's see the classification of where this procainamide lies in antiarrhythmic drug. So let's see the classification of antiarrhythmic drugs now. Now, antiarrhythmic drugs, they are classified on the basis of one scientific classification. The scientific classification is known as William Wogensink classification. Okay. Now, according to William Wogensink classification, they are divided antiarrhythmic drug into five classes. class 1, 2, 3, 4, and fifth is miscellaneous. So if you talk about 1, 2, 3, 4, it is known as SO-B-POCA. SO means sodium channel blocker. They are further divided into 1A, 1B, and 1C on the basis how they are interfering with potassium channel. Then we have beta blocker. They all end with the word LOL. Remember, all beta blocker are under class 2 except sotalol. Potassium channel blocker and calcium channel blocker. And certain miscellaneous drugs, PADAM, potassium, atropine, digoxin, adenosine, and magnesium sulfate. So this is the drugs among class 1 agent. Class 1 agent, they are sodium channel blocker. They are divided into 1A, 1B, and 1C. So they block sodium channel. As you can see, procainamide is class 1A. So how to remember their name? Class 1A, a mnemonic is Cupid. Quinidine, procainamide, diisopyramide. Class 1B, the mnemonic is leave PMT, lignocaine, phenytine, mexiletine, tokenide. Class 1C is effective PM, EFPM. Class 2, beta blockers, okay? They are ending with the word LOL, LOL. All beta blockers are under class 2 except sotalol. Remember, sotalol is under class 3. So this is a very important question. Class 3 agent, you can write a mnemonic, beautiful, divas. Beautiful means Brettanium, Divas means Dofetilide, Ibutilide, Vernacalant, Amiodarone and Sotalol. Then we have calcium channel blockers acting on heart, Verapamil and Diltiazam, and miscellaneous drugs we have already discussed. Now if you talk about their toxicity and how to manage it, we know that the toxicity, procainamide is class 1 agent. Class 1 are sodium channel blocker. Hence the antidote for sodium channel blocker, if you think this option, ideally, it should be sodium from outside. As it is a sodium channel blocker, hence the antidote should be sodium lactate or sodium bicarbonate. If you talk about class 2 agent, that is beta blocker. Beta blocker, remember beta blocker antidote is glucagon hormone. Okay, or we can also give atropine if glucagon is not given. We can give atropine because they will stimulate heart. Class 3 agent we know are potassium channel blocker. So you can give the antidote as potassium. And class 4 agent are calcium channel blockers. So their antidote is calcium gluconate. So here we give potassium chloride. Here we can give calcium gluconate. So the antidote is very easy to remember. Now, which of the following drugs can cause torsades de pointis? Now, remember, torsades de pointis occur due to increase in QT interval on ECG, and it occurs due to blockage of outward potassium channel on heart. Any drug which blocks potassium channel on heart can lead to torsades de pointis. And remember, among antiarrhythmic drug, there are two classes of antiarrhythmic drug known as class 1A, which block sodium as well as potassium. And class 3 agent, they are also potassium channel blocker. They block potassium channel. And these drugs, they can cause torsades de pointis. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see which of the agent is among which class. Quinidine is class 1A agent, lignocaine class 1B, Esmolol is a beta blocker, and flecainide is class 1C. So you have to find class 1A agent and 3. The answer is quinidine. Okay, so these two classes, they block potassium channel 1A and 3, and these two classes of antiarrhythmic drug can cause torsades de pointis. Now, which of the following is not an adverse effect of chronic amiodarone therapy? We have already discussed. Pulmonary fibrosis, true. Hypo and hyperthyroidism, true. So the answer is SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus. Now all of the following drugs can be used for the chronic oral treatment of arrhythmia except. So which of the following drug cannot be given orally? The answer is Esmolol. Okay. So Esmolol, remember, cannot be given orally. Remember, Esmolol is overall the shortest acting beta blocker. It is the overall shortest acting beta blocker. Okay. Now the point is why? Because when we give Esmolol, it gets rapidly degraded in our blood and in liver and intestine by esterases enzyme. So it cannot be given orally. And when it is given IV, even intravenous injection, it gets rapidly degraded in the blood. Hence, it must be given as a rapid IV infusion. It must be given as a rapid IV infusion. And so where it is used? As it is degraded very fast, it is given during emergencies. It is given during intraoperative tachycardias because it will have very short-lived action. It is given in intraoperative tachycardia. So if you talk about which of the following antiarrhythmic is short and long, remember overall, shortest acting antiarrhythmic drug is not Esmolol. Overall, shortest acting antiarrhythmic drug is adenosine. Okay? So adenosine. Why? Because the half-life of adenosine is 10 seconds. And the half-life of Esmolol is 9 minutes. So even the shortest acting is adenosine. Adenosine is also given by rapid IV infusion. And if you talk about the longest acting antiarrhythmic drug, it is amiodarone. Amiodarone is the longest acting antiarrhythmic drug. Its half-life is 58 days. You don't have to remember the half-life of amiodarone, but you have to remember the half-lives of your adenosine and Esmolol. Okay. Now, which of the following antiarrhythmic drug does not belong to class 1C? We have written the mnemonic effective PM, E for ecanide, flecainide, propafenone, and moricizine. So these are the four antiarrhythmic drug we have discussed. So the incorrect answer out here is tokenite. Tokenite is rather class 1B, while all other drugs are class 1C agent. Now all of the following statement is not true. So you have to find the incorrect statement about sotalol. Okay. Now let's talk about certain points about sotalol. Okay. Now LOL word is coming. Sotalol, remember, is a non-selective beta blocker. It's a non-selective beta blocker. We had already discussed in ANS section. Okay. It's a non-selective beta blocker. And we know it is the only beta blocker which is under class 3. The reason is it blocks potassium channel. Also, so this is the only beta blocker that blocks potassium channel. And remember, any drug which blocks potassium channel increases action potential duration, which may lead to increase in QT interval, which can lead to torsadiety pointis. Okay. Now, sotalol is one of the beta blocker which is not metabolized in liver. Remember, there are three main beta blockers which we have to remember, which are not metabolized in liver. It is excreted unchanged in urine. It is excreted unchanged in urine through kidney. Remember, it is contraindicated in renal failure. Okay, and remember, increase in action potential duration can lead to torsades de pointis. Another name of torsades de pointis is polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. Another name of torsades de pointis is polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. Now remember, only three beta blockers are not metabolized in liver, which is important for you. ANS. So they are excreted unchanged in kidney. One is atenolol, nadolol, and sotalol. Okay? Other are also there, like acebutolol is also there, but you have to remember ANS. So keep this thing in mind and solve the question number 35. It's a non-selective beta blocker. The answer is absolutely true. We have seen the complete list of beta blocker in ANS. It prolongs the action potential duration throughout the heart. Yes, it blocks potassium channel, which prolongs action potential duration, which can lead to torsades de pointis or polymorphic ventricular tachycardia can occur. True. Now the point is it excreted through bile following hepatic metabolism? The answer is false. So the false statement is C. It is not metabolized in liver. It is excreted unchanged in urine. Now in a patient of congenital prolonged QT syndrome with intermittent torsades de pointis, which of the following should be prescribed? Now remember, the treatment of congenital long QT syndrome, and if there is intermittent torsades de pointis, or you will write for prophylaxis of torsades de pointis, the drug of choice is beta blocker. But if the question comes, if a patient has acquired QT syndrome, long QT syndrome, and the patient is having acute attack of torsades de pointis. For acute attack of torsades de pointis, the drug of choice is magnesium sulfate. Remember, for prevention, long-term prevention, we give oral beta blockers. For acute treatment of torsades de pointis, we give intravenous injections of magnesium sulfate. Hence, here it is asking intermittent. That means we have to give drug on long-term basis to prevent. Hence, the answer is a beta blocker. All beta blocker, they end with the word LOL, LOL. Okay? So, don't jump to the question of magnesium sulfate. Try to find which type of torsades de pointis it is. Now, antiarrhythmic drug which cause torsades de pointis are, we have already discussed, class 1A agent and class 3 agent will cause torsades de pointis. So, class 1A agent, we had written a mnemonic, Cupid, that is quinidine, true, it will cause, diisopyramide and procainamide, true. So, these three drugs will cause QT prolongation. What about lignocaine? Lignocaine is class 1B. Propanolol is class 2. Okay, so these three drugs, first three drugs are class 1A agent. So they will cause torsades de pointis. Now all of the following antiarrhythmic drugs are correctly matched to their group. Now procainamide class 1, it's absolutely true, Cupid. Amiodarone class 3, absolutely true, beautiful divas. Esmolol class 4, false. Remember, esmolol is a beta blocker and beta blockers are under class 2. Okay, diltiazam, calcium channel blocker, class 4, true. So the incorrect answer is esmolol. Now, drug of choice for rapid correction of PSVT in non-asthmatic. Now, the point is the drug for acute PSVT or rapid correction of PSVT, that is paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia, is to block AV node, we give adenosine. We give IV adenosine. Okay. But the point is, the side effect of adenosine is, adenosine causes flushing and adenosine causes asthma. Hence, if the patient is asthmatic, remember, adenosine is absolutely contraindicated in asthmatic. So, if the question will come, it is given in asthmatic, remember, in asthmatic, adenosine is not given. Here, the drug of choice is calcium channel blocker acting on heart. That is verapamil. Okay, so verapamil is here will be the drug of choice. So what are the use of verapamil? We will write, verapamil is the drug of choice for acute PSVT in asthmatic patient because it will not cause asthma. It is also the drug of choice for long-term maintenance of PSVT. Because adenosine will act for 10 seconds, verapamil is a long-acting drug. And remember, they are also the drug of choice for any kind of SVT, that is supraventricular tachycardia. So these are the uses of verapamil. So here the answer is verapamil, not adenosine. Now the next question is asking, which of the following is wrongly matched combination of antiarrhythmic drug? Now mexiletine is class 1B, it's absolutely true, leave PMT. Verapamil, calcium channel blocker, class 4, absolutely true. Amiodarone, class 3, absolutely true. While lignocaine is false. Remember, lignocaine is not class 1A, it is rather class 1B. Okay? Now, all of the following drugs are class 1 antiarrhythmic drugs except. So, class 1 could be 1A, 1B and 1C. Quinidine, yes, it's class 1A. Procainamide, class 1A. Flecainide, class 1C. Propanolol is a beta blocker, it's class 2 agent. Which of the following antiarrhythmic drugs decrease action potential duration in Purkinje fiber? Now remember, if you will increase APD, action potential duration, you block potassium channel. And potassium channel is blocked by class 1A agent and class 3 agent that we already know. But if you want to reduce action potential duration, you have to open potassium channel. So that if the potassium will move outside the heart very rapidly, the total action potential duration will reduce. Remember, class 1B agent, they reduce action potential duration. And we have discussed the mnemonic leave PMT, that is lignocaine, phenytoin, mexiletine, and tokenite. So let's talk about which class they are. Quinidine is class 1A, flecainide class 1C, amiodarone class 3, and lignocaine class 1B. Hence the answer is lignocaine. Okay, hence the answer for this question is lignocaine. Now, all of the following reduce AV conduction except. Now, remember, among antiarrhythmic drugs which are AV node blocker, the drugs which are AV node blockers are, we will write, there are 3 to 4 drugs A, B, C, D. These 4 drugs act on AV nodal blocker, and where they are given, any AV nodal blocker, AV nodal blocker are given in SVT. SVT is supraventricular tachyarrhythmia, like atrial flutter and fibrillation, so that the impulse should not come into the ventricle. So the first drug is adenosine. Second is beta blockers, like esmolol, propranolol. Calcium channel blocker like verapamil. And D for digoxin, which is also known as digitalis. Digoxin is also known as digitalis. So these are the 4 AV nodal blocker given in the treatment of SVT. So which is not an AV nodal blocker? The answer here is lignocaine. Okay, lignocaine. Lignocaine have no effect on AV node. That is why lignocaine is not given. Lignocaine is never given in SVT. It cannot block AV node. Hence, lignocaine is only given in VT. Ventricular tachyarrhythmia. It is never given in SVT because in SVT we give AV nodal blocker. Now, class 3 antiarrhythmic drug is amiodarone, we already know, phenytoin 1B, propafenone 1C, pindolol, beta blocker class 1-2. Hence, the answer is amiodarone. A 16-year-old girl was found to have paroxysmal attack of rapid heart rate. Okay, the antiarrhythmic of choice in most cases of acute AV nodal tachycardia. So this is asking about paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia acute attack. We already know the drug of choice for acute PSVT is adenosine, unless and until there is no asthma. Otherwise, it will be verapamil. So the answer here is adenosine. Now, the drug of choice for ventricular arrhythmia due to myocardial infarction. Now remember, earlier the drug of choice for ventricular arrhythmia due to myocardial infarction was lignocaine. Lignocaine, remember, is also known as xylocaine. It is also known as lidocaine. But now this answer has been changed. Now the drug of choice for ventricular tachycardia after MI has become now amiodarone. Because amiodarone has better survival. The patient gets survival result or better mortality benefit. Lignocaine has no mortality benefit in ventricular tachycardia due to MI. Hence, the answer now has become amiodarone. Okay. Now, the drug of choice for ventricular premature beat due to digitalis toxicity. Remember, if a ventricle is beating again and again, suddenly in between, just block this stimulation of ventricle by giving beta blockers. Okay, hence the answer out here should be ventricular premature beat. The answer should be beta blockers. But if beta blocker is not given, then you will mark the answer as class 1B agent. That is lignocaine or phenytoin. Okay. So answer out here is phenytoin. Another name of phenytoin is diphenylhydentoin. So if you will make pheny and toin, it will become phenytoin. So let's talk about the treatment of arrhythmias due to digoxin. Okay. So suppose this is the heart. And if the whole heart is beating in rhythm, it can produce overall tachycardia. So the rhythm of the heart is normal, or overall it can produce bradycardia. Now if the heart is beating out of rhythm, let's say only atria is moving more as compared to ventricle, it is known as out of rhythm supraventricular tachyarrhythmia. Or if ventricle is moving higher rate, it is known as ventricular tachyarrhythmia. So remember out here, For tachycardia due to digoxin, the drug of choice is potassium chloride. Potassium can be considered as an antidote for digoxin. For bradycardia, the drug of choice is atropine. Atropine is overall the drug of choice for any cause of bradycardia, but definitive treatment is PIS. Implant an artificial pacemaker. If it is supraventricular tachyarrhythmia, give propranolol or beta blocker. And if specifically they are asking about ventricular arrhythmia, give class 1B agent. That is lignocaine or phenytoin. If lignocaine is not given, phenytoin. So this is the treatment of digitalis or digoxin induced arrhythmias. Now arrhythmia refractory to lignocaine can be treated by amiodarone. Remember, amiodarone we have is the best drug, best treatment for ventricular tachyarrhythmia. It is also the drug of choice for refractory arrhythmia. Okay, refractory arrhythmias. Now, quinidine acts on the heart by, we already know quinidine is a sodium channel blocker with potassium blocker. Class 1 agent, it blocks sodium as well as potassium channel. Okay, the ezetimibe. So now we have come to hypolipidemic drugs. So the classification, let's talk about the drugs, hypolipidemics. Now hypolipidemic means these drugs, they will decrease blood lipid level. Now remember, there are two kinds of lipid. One is straight chain lipid known as triglyceride. One is cyclical in nature. The cyclical in nature is known as cholesterol or sterol. So hypolipidemic means we have to reduce triglyceride level as well as cholesterol level. Okay, so let's talk about the classification of these drugs among hypolipidemics. So the classification of hypolipidemic drugs we can see is, first we have certain conventional drugs. For the first drug we have is HMG-CoA reductase inhibitor. These drugs are known as statins. And statins, they inhibit the synthesis of cholesterol by blocking this rate limiting step of HMG-CoA reductase enzyme. All these drugs will end with the word statin, like rosuvastatin, longest acting, simvastatin, etc. Then we have bile acid binders or sequestrant. They will remove cholesterol into the bile, and this bile will not reabsorb back into the liver through portal vein, enterohepatic circulation. They are known as resins. Resins, they will start with the word col, cholestyramine, cholestipol, cholecalciferol. Then we have lipoprotein lipase activators or PPAR alpha agonists. They are known as fibrates. Fibrates, they will end with the word fibrate, like clofibrate, bisafibrate, fenofibrate, and gemfibrozil. Then we have niacin, the only hypolipidemic which can also reduce lipoprotein A level niacin. Then we have a drug which will inhibit the absorption of cholesterol or sterol from the intestine. That drug is known as ezetimibe. So these are the drugs which are given in your books. But now we have certain newer drugs among hypolipidemic. So we have PCSK9 inhibitor. PCSK9 degrades LDL receptors on liver. If we will inhibit PCSK9 protein, the LDL uptake of the liver increases. Evolocumab, alirocumab, inclisiran. Then we have MTP inhibitor, that is microsomal triglyceride transfer protein. It will reduce the synthesis of VLDL. The drug is lomitapide. Lomitapide is having MTP word in between. Then we have ACAT1 inhibitor, that is acyl-CoA cholesterol acyl transferase inhibitor, which inhibit the formation of foam cells in macrophages. The drug is known as abacimib. It reduces atherosclerosis by foam cells. Then we have antisense oligonucleotide, which will inhibit mRNA function, mepomersine, given in familial hyperlipidemias. Then we have CETP inhibitor, cholesterol ester transfer protease inhibitor. They increase HDL level. So these drugs, they are enacitrapib, torsitrapib. They will have CETP word in between. Then we have omega-3 fatty acid like icosapentaenoic acid, known as icosapentaen, docosahexaenoic acid. Okay, so these are the drugs we have among hypolipidemic. So let's talk about their details now. So the first question is asking, ezetimibe acts by. So ezetimibe, remember, is a drug which inhibits the absorption of cholesterol or sterol from intestine into the blood or the lymph. Now to absorb this cholesterol into the lymph or blood, our intestinal cells need a transporter. The transporter name is NPC1L1 transporter. NPC1L1 full form is not required, but the full form is Niemann-Pick-like transporter. Through this transporter, our body absorbs cholesterol into the circulation. Ezetimibe, remember, inhibit this NPC1L1 transporter. Hence, it inhibits the absorption of cholesterol from intestine into the circulation. So the question is, ezetimibe acts by decreasing the absorption of cholesterol by inhibiting NPC1L1 transporter. Now, true about fibrates is all except. Now, fibrates are the drug of choice for type 3 hyperlipoproteinemia and severe hypertriglyceridemia. It's absolutely true. They activate PPAR receptor, that is peroxisomal proliferator activating receptor, and they increase the production of lipoprotein lipase enzyme LPS2. Remember, lipoprotein lipase enzyme removes triglyceride from the blood, and the level of triglyceride also increases in hyperlipoproteinemia, which is also known as dyslipoproteinemia. It is absorbed good on empty stomach, and absorption is delayed in fatty meals. Remember, it's false. Remember, all the hypolipidemic agents we give them along with fatty meals or with food. The absorption of hypolipidemic agents increase by food. Okay, so this is a false statement. Their side effect is rashes. Yes, most common. They cause allergy. All drugs can cause. All hypolipidemics can cause myalgia. Absolutely true. And they cause impotency. True. Okay, myalgia is a very characteristic side effect of hypolipidemic agent. They cause muscle pain. Okay, so the incorrect statement is false. All of the following are true about HMG-CoA reductase inhibitors except. So they are asking about statins now. Okay, so they are asking about statins. CNS accumulation of simvastatin and lovastatin is high and less for prava and fluvastatin. We don't know about, let's see, if you don't know about this any option, let's jump to the second question first. We don't know it's true or false. Simva is rapidly and prava is least metabolized. We don't know. Let's skip to the third option. Now, bioavailability is minimally modified when pravastatin is taken with food. Chalo, let's move forward. Now, fibrinogen level is decreased by pravastatin. We will mark this option as false. The reason is, remember, all statins, they have pleiotropic effect. All statins, they have pleiotropic effect. Pleiotropic effect of statin means, they have pleo means many, other beneficial effects of statin. Remember, apart from reducing cholesterol level by inhibiting HMG-CoA reductase, these statins, they can reduce atherosclerosis by various other mechanisms. Remember, in atherosclerosis, it's a hypercoagulable state, the level of fibrin increases. These statins, they reduce the level of fibrin. Hence, they will reduce the blockage of blood vessel. They reduce the attachment of platelets. Okay. They increase nitric oxide production. Hence, the blood vessel will remain dilated. Remember, they have antiplatelet, anticoagulant or antifibrin. They decrease the level of uric acid. So, they protect the cell. Uric acid is formed when the cell gets destroyed. They decrease C-reactive protein or inflammatory markers. Okay. So, these are the various other pleiotropic effect of statin. Hence, they can prolong the life of a person. And the answer is D. Only this D statement is false. Remember, statins, they reduce fibrinogen level, which is a good thing. Mechanism of action of statin, we already know. Statins, they inhibit HMG-CoA reductase enzyme. Statins, they inhibit HMG, that is hydroxymethyl glutaryl, CoA reductase enzyme. Now, this enzyme is the rate limiting step, and they inhibit this enzyme competitively. This enzyme is the rate limiting step which converts HMG into mevalonate. Okay, so it is inhibited. Remember, mevalonate is a precursor of cholesterol. So the level of cholesterol also reduces. Remember, cholesterol is a component of LDL. Low density lipoprotein contains cholesterol. Hence, the level of LDL also reduces. Now, how the level of LDL reduces? Let's see. Suppose, sir, in liver, if you will decrease the production of cholesterol by inhibiting HMG-CoA reductase enzyme in liver, can we say now the liver is not getting very less amount of cholesterol? Now remember, if liver requires cholesterol, it will start uptaking LDL from the blood, because LDL is the only protein in our body which can donate cholesterol to the body tissue. So decrease in production of cholesterol in the liver by HMG coreductase enzyme increase the receptors of LDL on liver. And increase in receptors of LDL on liver will reduce the blood LDL level. So this is their main mechanism of action of statin. They reduce the blood LDL level by inhibiting the synthesis of cholesterol in liver. Liver will take cholesterol which is present in LDL in the blood. So the answer for this question, if you see this question, is it inhibits HMG-CoA synthase. The answer is false. It is rather reductase. Stimulate reductase, false. It is rather an inhibitor of reductase. It indirectly increases the level of LDL receptor synthesis. Its answer is absolutely true. That is why the liver will reuptake LDL from the blood. It inhibits intestinal cholesterol absorption, false. That was ezetimibe which was inhibiting the intestinal cholesterol absorption. Now, which of the following hypolipidemic agent causes gout? Gout means hyperuricemia, which can increase uric acid level. Now remember, statins and fibrates, they decrease uric acid level. And the only hypolipidemic agent which increases uric acid level is niacin. Niacin rather increases uric acid level, and niacin can cause gout. Gout is a contraindication of using niacin. But this niacin has a very great advantage. It is the only hypolipidemic agent we have which can decrease lipoprotein A level. Lipoprotein A is an oxidative marker of atherosclerosis. It's a modified form of LDL. So answer is ezetimibe, no. Fibrozil is a fibrate. Statin, no. So the answer out here is niacin. Lipid lowering drug that can reduce lipoprotein A level is niacin. Niacin is also known as nicotinic acid. Now, clofibrate, a lipid lowering agent, inhibits both cholesterol and triglyceride synthesis. So it's a fibrate, and we know that fibrate is a lipoprotein lipase activator. These fibrate, remember, they go inside the cell and they will act on an intranuclear receptor known as PPAR alpha agonist. PPAR stands for peroxisomal proliferator activating receptor. If you will stimulate this receptor by fibrate, this receptor is located on genes or DNA, it will start producing a protein or an enzyme known as lipoprotein lipase enzyme. And remember, lipoprotein lipase enzyme removes triglyceride and very less of cholesterol from the blood. It mainly removes triglyceride from the blood, hence fibrates are the drug of choice for hypertriglyceridemia. So let's talk about this question. Inhibit HMG-CoA reductase, false. Remember, it is the main mechanism of action of statins. It binds to bile and prevent its absorption, false. It's absolutely the main mechanism of action of raisins. It inhibit VLDL production, it's absolutely false. Okay, niacin can inhibit VLDL production. Okay, it activates lipoprotein lipase enzyme, resulting in degradation of VLDL. It's absolutely true, because VLDL contains maximum amount of triglycerides. Hence, the true statement is this one. Now, in a patient of hypertriglyceridemia and low HDL, which of the following best drug will be given without the risk of myopathy? Remember, the only hypolipidemic agent which will not cause myopathy is niacin. The hypolipidemic agent which causes myopathy are statins and fibrates. Statins and fibrates, they cause myopathy. Niacin will not cause myopathy. Hence, the answer is niacin or nicotinic acid. Okay? And remember, niacin is the best agent we have which can increase HDL level in the blood. And it is the best agent we have which can reduce lipoprotein A level in the blood. Okay? So remember this part. So if you talk about which hypolipidemic agent will produce which effect, let's make a summary. So if you make four drug, that is statin, resin, fibrates and niacin. These are the four main hypolipidemic agent, niacin. Let's talk about their level on LDL. Remember, LDL contains cholesterol, let's write C. Then you will write triglyceride and HDL. Remember, a patient to be healthy, LDL and triglyceride level should reduce and the level of HDL should increase in the body if you want to remain healthy. So if you talk about statin, statin will reduce LDL level, reduce triglyceride level, increase HDL level, and among them, the maximum reduction in LDL is by statin. Resins, they also reduce LDL level. They increase triglyceride level, which is a bad thing. They also increase HDL level. If you talk about fibrate, they reduce LDL level. They reduce triglyceride level maximum. They increase HDL. Niacin, reduce, increase maximum. So maximum reduction in LDL is by statin. Maximum reduction in triglyceride is by fibrate. Maximum increase in HDL is by niacin. Okay? Maximum. And niacin is the only molecule which can also reduce lipoprotein A level. Niacin is the only molecule we have which can decrease lipoprotein A level. It is the only hypolipidemic we have which can reduce lipoprotein A level. So HDL is specifically increased by, best answer is niacin. All of them are increasing HDL, but the best answer you will go by is niacin. Now, the most potent drug to reduce plasma cholesterol level. Remember, cholesterol means LDL. And the best agent to reduce cholesterol level or LDL level is statins. Hence, the answer is statins. Now, which of the following drug is associated with highest cardiac mortality? So it's a question of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, that is rofecoxib. So we have already discussed in autocoids, its selective COX-2 inhibitor increases cardiac mortality. Which of the following drug is used for reversal of cerebral vasospasm, infarct following subarachnoid hemorrhage? We have already discussed which calcium channel blocker can cross meninges. Cerebroselective, that is nimodipine. Okay, nimodipine. Now, evobradine is indicated in management of. Let's talk about what is evobradine. Now, evobradine, remember, it inhibit SA node. Why? It inhibit funny channels on SA node. Now, what are these funny channels on SA node? Funny channels are inward sodium potassium current, which makes this sodium SA node partially depolarize. That is why SA node is the first cell in the heart to generate an impulse. It's a pacemaker. That is why funny channel is also known as pacemaker potential. It is also known as pacemaker potential. So if you inhibit that, SA node will suppress. Can we say SA node increases heart rate? Hence, can we say it will produce bradycardia? So it will, evobradine will produce bradycardia. That is why you are seeing brady word is coming. Evobradine. So it's a pure heart rate lowering drug. It reduces heart rate. Now it has two uses. It is used in CHF, congestive heart failure, and it is given in chronic stable angina, because it will reduce the workload of the heart. What is the side effect? The side effect of evobradine is bradycardia. The heart rate will become too narrow and it causes visual disturbance. It generally causes day blindness. The reason is these funny channels are also present in retina, where they are known as IH current. Okay, that is why they cause visual disturbance. So this is all about evobradine. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see, it is indicated in the management of congestive heart failure, angina pectoris. So these are the two options which are true. Not cardiomyopathy, not irritable bowel syndrome. Okay. Now, which of the following statement regarding ACE inhibitor is true?